to seal or not to seal? That is the question. I'm Lizelle Brandt, and welcome to another edition of the Trojan Law Blitz, where I talk legal issues in Trojan sports. In this edition, we're talking the LA Times and New York Times application to unseal the records of the NCAA in the lawsuit of Todd McNair versus the NCAA. For more of a detailed background of what was going on that brought us to this place, make sure you check out my first video, which is Todd McNair versus NCAA, a recap. On Monday, the Court of Appeals is going to hear oral argument as to the issue only of the sealing of the records. Now, why are we even in the Court of Appeal? Well, the NCAA had filed a motion to dismiss Todd McNair's lawsuit against it and also had filed to seal the records that went on in that investigation in the lower court. And the lower court actually denied them, in effect said, McNair, go ahead, proceed with your case. And yes, these records should be unsealed because the public has a right to know. And the NCAA did not like that ruling, so they wanted it checked. They went to a higher authority, the Court of Appeals, and on Monday we'll be talking about their right to seal the records. What does the NCAA need to prove in order to allow its records to be sealed? First, they need to prove that there exists an overriding interest that overcomes the public right of access. Second, they need to prove an overriding interest supports the sealing of the record. Third, they need to prove that a substantial probability exists that the overriding interest will be prejudiced if the record is not sealed. Fourth, they need to prove the proposed sealing is narrowly tailored. And fifth, they need to prove that no less restrictive means exists. Now, the first three elements are somewhat in the same family in that they all describe an overriding interest and prejudice that is suffered if the records don't get sealed. The NCAA's argument in this situation is threefold. First, they mention that the bylaws of the NCAA require that they keep all of the records sealed. Second, they argue confidentiality of the witnesses, which is probably the stronger argument. What they're saying is that they don't have subpoena power, and so all of their investigations require witnesses to voluntarily come forward so that they can conduct their investigation. Now, if the witnesses' confidential information is made public, the NCAA fears that this will set a chilling to future investigations, that other witnesses aren't going to be willing to come forward if they're not really sure that their private information will be out there. The third thing that I thought was interesting that the NCAA has mentioned in its argument is that Todd McNair would not want some of the items disclosed in these investigations out in the public. So that is a little bit of an interesting item. On the flip side of things, the media is arguing that there absolutely is an overriding interest of public access. They point directly to Judge Schaller's ruling and him mentioning that he saw machinations of malicious acts, and also that he believes, the judge believes, that the public has a right to know what's going on. The last two elements that the NCAA needs to prove are also somewhat related in that they require the NCAA to show that their request to get these records sealed is quote unquote narrowly tailored, and also that there are less restrictive means of accomplishing the situation. What are my thoughts on these first three elements and whether or not the NCAA is going to meet them? I think this is somewhat of a little bit of a toss-up. They do have a strong argument as to confidentiality of witnesses and making sure that their investigations are not chilled. But on the flip side, did the NCAA really screw up here? Was this a witch hunt? Did they act maliciously? And if so, the public might have a right to know. In these three elements, I'd say it's somewhat balanced. Where I've got a problem is in the last two elements, and let's talk about them. The last two elements to get the records sealed involve making sure that the NCAA's request is quote unquote narrowly tailored, which means it isn't too broad, and second, that it is the least restrictive methods of accomplishing what they're trying to get. Now, let's talk about the first one in terms of, is this narrowly tailored? Well, the NCAA is looking to seal records that include the appellate record, 700 pages of it, the opening brief of the NCAA, interview transcripts, declarations of key witnesses, emails, all opposition briefs, routine legal argument, McNair's response to the notice, and quite frankly, this does sound a little bit broad. The media is hammering the NCAA on this. Is this more information that they need to get sealed? Probably. And one of the arguments is that some of these interviews and some of these communications don't even involve confidential witnesses. They're actually internal communications within the NCAA. Is that something that needs to be sealed? Probably not. The last element that the NCAA needs to overcome is to show that their request is the least restrictive means to accomplishing what they're trying to get at. So again, I see a problem here. What the NCAA is saying is we want these complete records sealed, but there's a really strong argument, I do this all the time, that you can produce those records and protect the confidentiality of witnesses if you just redact it, which is another word for not whiteout, but blackout. You cross out the names of the people that are involved and you can completely protect their privacy. Or you can call them by aliases, which the NCAA does as well. In fact, when it released its findings in the McNair case, you would see it referring to student athlete number one or coach, assistant coach number two, items like that. There definitely is a way that these records could be redacted or blacked out to protect the confidentiality of the witnesses, and that's where I think that the NCAA has a strong weakness. Now, what about the judges? Here in the Court of Appeals in Division III, which is the division that is reviewing it, it's actually a panel that's going to be reviewing it. It's not one judge, it's going to be three judges selected out of four. Now, who are these judges? We are not going to know exactly who's going to be hearing it until the morning of the hearing. Where did Todd McNair and his attorneys fall on this? What's interesting is that in the lower court, when this application to seal the records was initially filed by the NCAA, McNair didn't oppose it. But when the transcript came out in terms of the argument over whether or not to unseal it later on in November of 2012, McNair's attorneys said that they did not oppose the unsealing of the records. And in the Court of Appeals case, they've actually filed a brief, but what's interesting here is that this roughly 70-page brief, only about 9 pages of it are devoted to the argument in which they would support the unsealing of the records and oppose the NCAA's motion to seal it. Another thing that's interesting about this case is that originally the Court of Appeals was going to hear argument on the two matters, first being whether or not the McNair case could proceed on its merits in the lower court, in other words, whether or not to dismiss it as the NCAA had argued, and the second, whether or not to seal the records as the NCAA has been requesting of the court. Now, on Monday's hearing, the court decided that it was only going to hear oral argument as to the issue of the sealing of the records. And that's interesting because it makes you wonder, are they actually thinking of settling this case? Is this going to be dispositive? Has the court already made its decision as to the merits of the case? That is something that we'll have to learn on Monday or after. That'll do it for us here at the Trojan Law Blitz. If there are any topics that you want us to cover, you can email me at Lizelle@SingianLaw.com or tweet me to @LizelleBrandt. If you like this video, make sure you subscribe to this channel. And for even more on your USC Trojans, visit www.wersc.com. At the USC Gould School of Law, I'm Lizelle Brandt. You're watching WeRSC.